We are building a new way.
We are building a new way. We are building a new way, feeling stronger every day. We are building a new way.
We can feed on every need,
every need.
We can feed,
we can feed on
every need,
every need.
We can feed on every need. Start with love, that is the seed. We can feed.
We are building a new way.
We are building a new way. We are building a new way, feeling stronger every day. We are building a new way.
Freedom is our cry.
We are building.
We can take a moment to grieve that loss. Welcome to worship this morning. The title of our worship today is called, it's called Implicit versus Explicit, Do We Need an Eighth Principle of Unitarian Universalism? Good morning, everyone. I am the Reverend Dr. Suzanne Intrilligator. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I welcome you to worship this morning. Our goal here, as always, is not perfection, but connection with one another, with ourselves, and with divinity, however we each define that. Helping me create that sense of connection today are our volunteers. We've got Mary Ellen Fitzgibbon is our in-person usher this morning. And on Zoom, Cassandra Koudelidis is our chat host today. It's her first time. Be gentle. Thank you both. Our new worship technician, Bill, is flying solo this morning. And Dan Griscom is having a well-deserved day off at home. Let's keep our fingers crossed. Today is a really, really busy day at our church. So I just want to remind you of three other events that are happening today. Right after our worship service, we'll do our usual breakout rooms on Zoom, and we'll have our conversation hour on the front lawn for a little while. Then we'll come back in here, if you like. Of course, it's optional. Get back into this hybrid space for our first ever hybrid fall finance forum. That's when our treasurer, Jill Libby, will go through the budget with us. She will explain how we changed things from last year and what our plan is for this year and how we're doing so far. So if you can be part of that, of course, we encourage that. If you have any questions about how our money is used or managed, now's the time to ask. Then later today, after all of that, we'll be participating, many of us, in the 26th annual fundraising walk for the Melrose Alliance Against Violence. Thank you to all the donors and walkers participating today. Go team. Then tonight at 8, we have the second installment of the second season of Opening Doors, our online anti-racism concert series. Tonight, Alistair Mook interviews Kelly Hall Tompkins, who is a virtuoso violinist and a Broadway star. It'll be really interesting. Of course, next Sunday, October 31st, is Halloween. So Tara and I are feeling like want to come up with some fun surprises. Join us for a worship service that focuses on monsters, both real and imagined monsters. And feel free to wear costumes or silly hats, or if you're on Zoom, to use the funny filters and backgrounds, and we'll try to have a good time next week. Today in our worship, we'll be talking about the proposed eighth principle of Unitarian Universalism, which calls us to make an explicit commitment to dismantling oppressions like racism in ourselves and in our institutions. So, like every Sunday, it's a really good time to recall that our church sits on lands that by rights still belong to the native Massachusetts people. If you want to know more about how to support descendants of these original occupants of our land, please go to maindigenousagenda.org. On that website, within a minute, you will learn how you can support our state's remaining indigenous people and change and do things that they would like us to do to support them. Speaking of help and support, we've noticed that there's a little bit of a lag in our Zoom presentation from the sanctuary, and we're trying to upgrade our Wi-Fi service. In the meantime, it would be helpful if people here in the room didn't use our Wi-Fi so that we can focus it on putting out our Zoom worship. Thank you. And also, folks here in the room, if you'd like to share a joy or a sorrow with us later in the service, there are little slips of paper out in Brick Hall. If you missed that on the way in, raise your hand now, and Mary Ellen, our usher, will come by with pen and paper. Make sure you get your little slips of paper back to her. We have, you may have noticed, a real participatory ethic in our worship together. This morning, even more so, we're very lucky and fortunate to have three members of our choir who are going to give us a live performance in the sanctuary, which we haven't had in, 20 months now or something like that. That's exciting, and we're grateful to them. Also, we have three members of our anti-racism team who are going to share in the sermon today. So it'll be a participatory four-way sermon. That should be interesting. And just to, I want to make sure that people in the room are also empowered, and people on Zoom. If we're having any kind of audio or tech issues, everyone is empowered. Please, to, if you're here with me, raise your hand and say, Reverend Suzanne, we can't hear you. We're getting used to these new white noise machines that are among us. And if you can't hear, please raise your hand. I don't want you to miss anything. People on Zoom, if you're having any problems, let us know in the chat. Cassandra, the host, can go ahead and open her mic and tell us and speak to us. So just so we can check in with all the people who are here and go ahead and get started, we're going to do our customary greeting. So people here in the room, wave to each other, do some hug shooters if you like, say hello and good morning. People on Zoom, go ahead and switch to your grid view, the gallery view it's called, and we can page through. Maybe we can show that even here in the service. Thanks for being part of our worship this morning. So now it's time to settle into worship, if you would. I call us into worship this morning with these words by the Reverend Rebecca Parker, who was the dean of our UU theology school at Star King. She wrote, "This is my country. Love calls me beyond denial and disassociation. It is not enough to think of racism as a problem of human relations to be cured by treating everyone fairly. My commitment to racial justice is both on behalf of the other, my neighbor, whose well-being I desire, and for myself, to whom the gift of life has been given, but not yet fully claimed. I struggle neither as a benevolent act of social concern, nor as a repentant act of shame and guilt, but as an act of desire for life, of passion for life, of insistence on life, fueled both by love for life and anger in the face of the violence that divides human flesh." Now, along with UUs everywhere, we will light the symbol of our faith, the flaming chalice. This morning, our chalice will be lit by Beth Harris, and she will give us a reading to go along with it. Thank you, Beth.
This morning's chalice lighting comes from Deanna Vandiver. We light this chalice, symbol of our faith alive in this world, naming our vision of collective liberation and daring to remember each other into beloved community.
Our opening hymn this morning uses new lyrics to an old tune, and they are written especially for our times. Composer Amanda Udis Kessler offers a lot of her work to liberal religious congregations for free on her website, queersacredmusic.com, and we are so grateful to her for this gift. Please join me in singing "We Are Gathered." For those of you who are in the sanctuary, you were handed this lyrics to this hymn as we are walking in.
We are gathered in the Spirit, though our bodies are apart, filled with joy and touched with one. Separate hands, but mingled hearts.
You may be seated. Go ahead. Thank you. Oh, you know what? I lied. I'm sorry. I forgot. If you would remain standing, this is where we usually join in the words of our covenant, followed by our song of affirmation. But today I wanted to try something a little tiny bit different. I wanted to ask us to join together in our other covenant, the seven principles of Unitarian Universalism. Sorry, I don't need that. Joined and followed by the proposed eighth principle, so that you might hear it today in its context and imagine what it might feel like to live with it. To get it, this is today only, and it is an experiment. It's by no means binding in any way. If you could please join us in the words of our principles here in the room, if you need them. The first seven principles, they're in your hymnal in the very first pages, and they're up there if you can see them. All right, let's go. We, the member congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association, covenant to affirm and promote, one, the inherent worth and dignity of every person, two, justice, equity, and compassion in human relations, three, acceptance of one another and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations, four, a free and responsible search for truth and meaning. Five, the right of conscience and the use of the democratic process in our congregations and in society at large. Six, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. Seven, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. And the proposed eighth principle, journeying towards spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and in our institutions. Thank you. And now our song of affirmation. Be seated. Now it is time for our story. Today, Katie asks us to focus on how to raise our kids with our values. The story today is Anti-Racist Baby by Ibram X. Kendi.
Anti-racist baby is bred, not born. Anti-racist baby is raised to make society transform. Babies are taught to be racist or anti-racist. There's no neutrality. Take these 9 steps to make equity a reality. 1, open your eyes to all skin colors. Anti-racist baby learns all the colors, not because race is true. If you claim to be colorblind, you deny what's right in front of you. 2, use your words to talk about race. No one will see racism if we only stay silent. If we don't name racism, it won't stop being so violent. 3, point at policies as the problem, not people. Some people get more while others get less because policies don't always grant equal access. 4, shout. There's nothing wrong with the people. Even though all races are not treated the same, we are all human, anti-racist baby can proclaim. 5, celebrate all our differences. Anti-racist baby doesn't see certain groups as better or worse. Anti-racist baby loves a world that is truly diverse. 6, knock down the stack of cultural blocks. Anti-racist baby appreciates how groups speak, dance, and create as they choose. Anti-racist baby welcomes all groups voicing their unique views. 7, confess when being racist. Nothing disrupts racism more than when we confess the racist ideas that we sometimes express. 8, grow to be an anti-racist. Anti-racist baby is always learning, changing, and growing. Anti-racist baby stays curious about all people and isn't all-knowing. 9, believe we shall overcome racism. Anti-racist baby is filled with the power to transcend and doesn't judge a book by its cover, but reads until the end.
Each week we take time for reflection. We create a place for each of us to center ourselves in our own way. So let's start this week by relaxing into our chairs, feeling our feet on the floor, letting our bodies settle. Let us breathe in and out together. In this meditation time, first we'll join in our centering song, then we'll sit for a few minutes of shared silence, then we'll speak to one another of our joys and sorrows. Then I will lead a prayer. Our worship theme for October is cultivating relationship, and so our centering song all month long is "How Could Anyone?" Please feel free to sing along. After the song, 2 minutes of silence.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply your
Now our weekly practice of sharing with one another the joys and sorrows of our lives, the personal milestones that we share, and we speak and we witness them, holding them in compassion so that we might grow into an ever stronger community. First, if you have a sorrow to share today, I ask you to go ahead and type it into the chat. I will read those in a minute. First, Mary Ellen, do we have any sorrows on paper to share? Sorry, this. No, it says it's on. Maybe get right up close to it.
A concern from Mary H. Keep me in your thoughts for a difficult situation.
Any others, Mary Ellen?
And a sorrow from Lily R. My hamster, Leo, hope I have that name right, died yesterday. He was a good boy, and I will miss him quite a bit.
Thank you. Do we have any other sorrows today? I don't see any here in the chat. But let us take a moment, if we can, to hold all the sorrows that have been spoken, the two and all those that are unspoken. Let us hold them in our hearts. Let us remember to reach out with love to all who are hurting today and offer our support and help. Mary Ellen, go ahead and light this one candle as a beacon of our care for all of the sorrows in our hearts this morning. Now I'm going to go ahead and ask for any joys that we want to share. People on Zoom can go ahead and type them into the chat box, and I will read them shortly. Thanks, Mary Ellen. Do we have any joys on paper to read?
A joy from Anna R. I'm going to talk to my doctor to figure out if I have ADHD. Another joy from Cheryl R. Lily got approved for adenoid surgery, waiting for a date from the ENT.
Tara sends me a message for the sorrows. I forgot to grieve the loss of the Red Sox. Yeah, that is a grief that many of us are sharing this morning. But now to joys. From Heather M. My uncle just survived COVID. We are very grateful. That is a joy to share. From Jean T. A gratitude. I'm grateful for Bill Holt, our new Sunday worship tech guru, for helping us enjoy worship on Sundays. Welcome. And thanks to Dan Griscom for training Bill and working so hard to get our new hybrid worship set up. That is a good joy. Thank you for sharing that, Jean. From Jane Foley, please see Heather's Candle of Sorrow. Ah, also joy. See, did I miss Heather's Candle of Sorrow? Ah, I saw Heather's Candle as a candle of joy. It's mixed. Her uncle survived COVID. It is a joy and a sorrow. Thank you, Jane. Jane also says she spent the last 2 days with Julia at her family weekend at Northeastern, and that was a joy. From Ann Noonan, another joy, remembering the life of Ethel Hennigan, who attended our church for a while several years ago. And I believe she died recently, and Ann shared her obituary in our Facebook group. I think those are all the joys we have. Let me just check with Cassandra. Cassandra, our chat host, did I miss any joys or sorrows in the Zoom room?
You did not miss any.
Thank you. So let us take a moment while you go ahead and light that. We'll take a moment and just remember to thank everyone for sharing their joys. They help us to connect to one another, and they remind us of all of our many blessings. We light one more candle to shine out our thanks for all the joy in our lives. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. From the busy swirl of our daily lives, from all that we strive to remember, to do, to care for, to accomplish, give us pause in this moment. On this chilly fall morning, when change is in the very air, give us pause. O great spirit of life, give us a moment to breathe, to rest together. Remind us, O gentle spirit, to hold ourselves lightly, to make space gingerly for all our cares and concerns, to face ourselves and our humanness with kindness and forgiveness and love. Here together in this sacred space, we remind ourselves that we can be, that even we long to be, gentle and patient, tender and vulnerable, forgiving toward ourselves and each other. Like an autumn leaf floating on the breeze, we rest here in the spirit, sensing and feeling and knowing that we are safe and supported and loved. Amen. Now it is time for our offertory. Our church is an independent organization supported by your generous annual pledge. You may also contribute to our weekly collection plate, which we split every month with a deserving cause. You can donate either way using the orange button at the top right corner of our homepage at melroseuu.com. No, melroseuu.org, excuse me. Folks here in the room can leave their donations in the back. There's a collection plate. For October, our giving partner is Women for Afghan Women, a grassroots organization dedicated to protecting and promoting the rights of Afghan women and girls. And now Tara is going to share with us some beautiful offertory music.
For our offertory music this morning, we have a treat. For the first time since early March 2020, a group of our singers have prepared a piece together and will be performing it live in the sanctuary. Thank you, Beth, John, and Randall, for offering this to us. They will sing Da Pacem Domine, composed by late Renaissance composer Melchior Franck. The words translate, "Give us peace, Lord. May we know peace in our days."
No, it's nice right on your note.
Da pa cha pa cha do mi ne
da pa cha
pa cha do mi ne di da cha do sto sto da cha pa cha do mi ne
da
pa cha do mi ne
Thank you. That was beautiful. I feel like we have been blessed. And now it's time for our sermon. Now, I bet that we have all seen movies or TV shows where a longtime married couple renew their vows. Instead of poetic promises, they say things like, "From now on, I promise I'll pick up my dirty socks." Or, "I promise not to watch the next episode without you." Because change. Even the best relationships change over time. And so it makes sense that the promises we make, even the ones at the very heart of our most important relationships, they would change too. Little tiny history lesson for you. In 1960, when the Unitarian and Universalist denominations decided to merge, each came to the table with its own mission and faith statement. The two groups struggled for months to define their common ground. What would be the core statement of the new merged denomination? How would the two churches, in effect, get married? For months, they disagreed over whether or how to mention God or Christianity. Finally, after an all-day, all-night debate on the topic, the two groups came up with six principles they could both accept, and the merger went through, thankfully. But 10 to 15 years later, cracks began to show in the union. The Women's Federation documented the low numbers of women in leadership and ministry at the time, and they linked this situation to official documents that referred to all leaders as he. The women objected that these six original principles celebrated, quote, brotherhood, the dignity of men, and the men of goodwill. The Federation asked its members, "Do these principles affirm us as women?" And the resounding answer came back, "No, they do not." So in 1981, a non-sexist revision of the principles was presented to the General Assembly. And in a nod to a growing contingent of environmentalists and pagans, the proposal also omitted any language about our Judeo-Christian heritage, and that also caused a great stir among more traditional UUs. In order then to avoid an all-out confrontation on the floor of GA, the leader of the Women's Federation suggested something bold. Instead of calling a vote, she suggested that they set up a one-year study commission in the hope that that commission could create a stronger, more inspiring, more inclusive set of new principles. The commission got to work. They sent out questionnaires to congregations and individuals across the country, and then they carefully assembled all the data. The next year, 1982, they brought back a report to the GA that was then discussed in 100 small groups. A new draft came back the next year, 1983. And then finally the following year, 1984, there was a draft of new principles that was adopted by a large margin. And then of course the next year, 1985, it was affirmed yet again, as our principles call us to do, 2 votes to change our bylaws. So it was a long and national and exhaustive process, and still the principles are not set in stone. Our bylaws also require us to re-examine the principles formally every 15 years and to see whether or not they still fit. In 2009, another study commission proposed several changes to them, but those changes were then defeated at the GA. So that's a possibility too. Sometimes even UUs say no to change. In 2018, another new commission was formed, and they revisited the principles yet again. They're currently doing that. Over these few years, they're considering calls to change the 1st, the 5th, and the 7th principles, also to think about the proposed 8th principle. In addition to all that, they're also exploring whether the principles themselves are an effective or inspiring format. Maybe it's time for something brand new that we don't even imagine right now. The commission will issue their recommendation at GA next spring, and then of course we'll all get a chance to vote on it and discuss it in the next 2 years. Our congregation can and should be involved in this important process. But the purpose of our worship today is to focus your attention on the proposed 8th principle. In 2017, a grassroots group brought this idea to the whole GA. What if, in addition to these 7 high-minded principles that we've had now since 1985, they're rather abstract, and they imply that we will work for justice in the world, but what if we added one that literally commits us to do this work? Bill, if you could go ahead and put that slide back up. Thank you, Bill. So I know it's a lot of language, and there has already been a lot of discussion about all this language. There's a lot to unpack and discuss about it, and believe me, we're planning to discuss it. Over the next year, or maybe even 2, the anti-racism team, the board, and I aim to host several different kinds of events where you can get all can get a chance to look at it, give feedback, ask questions, or maybe 2 chances or 3 chances. For now, just to get us started, I want to point out 2 important pieces of this proposal, 2 things that I think would be radically new for us. First, this text points us toward a spiritual goal, beloved community. What is that? That is a phrase that Martin Luther King Jr. used a lot to speak about the ultimate goal of his work and his life. He wrote, "The end is reconciliation. The end is redemption. The end is the creation of the beloved community. It is this type of spirit and this type of love that can transform opposers into friends. It is this love which will bring about miracles." Pointing us toward beloved community is a strong theological stand. This is what makes this a principle on the same grounds as the other 7. The second important point I want to make is that this text invites us into accountability. It says that not only do we have to do the work of dismantling racism and other oppressions, but we can and we should check up on that work. We should ask ourselves and one another, ask our UU siblings of color, are we doing enough? Are we listening? Are we acting? Are we changing? As of last week, 125 of our 1,000 UU organizations had already voted to adopt the 8th principle to make it part of their own individual church covenants. So individual churches can do that. They can say, we have 8 principles instead of 7. Our anti-racism team would like us to explore that possibility, just to think about it and to start to talk about it. And now 3 members of that team would like to come forward and share their reflections with you, some of their decision-making process about inviting us into this conversation. First is Dan Franklin.
Thank you, Reverend Suzanne. So the 8th principle, do we need it? Isn't it implicit in the other principles? Well, we've made great progress in opening up our churches in other areas. Today we have many ministers who are women, who are gay, who are trans. We were the only major religious denomination that wholeheartedly accepted and performed gay marriages without any division. On race, though, there is still much work to do. In 2017, the UUA administration was rocked by upheaval when a white man was chosen as a regional administrator, retaining the all-white makeup of the regional administration. And the president told the BIPOC candidate that she was not a good fit for the position, a phrase that's heard too often by BIPOCs when they are turned down. For UUs of color, this event was a painful echo of a similar upheaval that happened in our denomination decades before. In 1969, there was a demand for more support for Black UUs, culminating in a promise of funding that was later curtailed. More important than history is that we hear repeatedly from Black UUs, even today, that they do not find our services welcoming. Shannon Lang, a member of Black Lives of Unitarian Universalism, says, "I love my congregation, but as a Black woman, before I enter the doors of my church or a committee meeting, I often feel like I have to put on my armor. Chances are someone's going to say something hurtful. They're not going to mean it, but it's going to happen. And I've got to gird myself up for the unintended pain that will come." She adds, "When I attend Black Lives of Unitarian Universalism worship services, which are Black-only sacred spaces, I feel like I am home, I am comforted, I am nourished." Shannon Lang goes on, "My hope is that every member of each UU congregation pledges to do their individual anti-racism and anti-oppression work, that every member searches honestly within themselves and analyzes their individual part in creating an atmosphere that has historically been unwelcoming to Black and brown siblings of color." The message from UUs of color is clear. They are asking us to make a clear commitment to rooting out white systems of power and privilege in our thinking and in our behavior. As we have before, let us rise to the challenge. Thank you.
I'd like to share an experience that opened my eyes to my own unconscious racial bias. My son-in-law, Yogi, is a brown-skinned Israeli. In the US, he is often mistaken for a Latino, Arab, or Black person. He was also once called the N-word when he darted across the street in Melrose. About 6 years ago, Yogi and the rest of our family were visiting the Peabody Essex Museum in Salem. While looking at paintings from the 18th and 19th century, Yogi matter-of-factly pointed out to me that all the dark-skinned people in the paintings were either servants or slaves. I vividly remember wondering how I hadn't seen that. At that moment, I became more aware of the countless ways I view the world with a biased racial lens, and it's not okay. I felt stronger at that moment, more energized, and more committed to understanding racism and speaking out. Last February, I joined the anti-racism team. At that time, we were focused on Alistair's Opening Doors series. When Dan Franklin brought the eighth principle to our attention, we weren't sure if we should add it to our list of actions. We already had a lot on our plate. However, as the ART explored the eighth principle, we realized that a commitment to anti-racism must be woven into everything we do. It is our work. And it reminded me how much I'd learned from my son-in-law. I want to stay on this path. I understand we are in a pandemic, and some may view our interest in exploring the eighth principle as a congregation as a big ask, a heavy load. But I believe this journey will feed the soul individually and collectively. For me, it is expansive, necessary, and even liberating. We have much to do and much to learn.
Hi, I'm Josh Shortledge. I've taken two anti-racism courses that were intellectually stimulating, but the totally lacked community afterwards. It was disheartening with both classes to see our awakenings wither when tasked with bringing about change alone. Human hearts blossom when working in concert with others. UU churches offer just such an opportunity. Our individual worth and dignity are respected. We are encouraged to embrace our own beliefs and even our own God. We agree to disagree, and at the same time, we support each other's ideas. Now that's unconditional love. Think how tedious raking leaves alone is. Now imagine having 150 helpers, some older and wiser, some younger and more robust, and a healthy dose of kids frolicking in the leaves. Now imagine a better project than raking leaves. Imagine us all building the most beloved community we can collectively envision, with our kids, with our parents, and with our other MUUC friends. What would this experience be like? One, two, three, go.
Thank you so much, Josh and Beth and Dan. You've given us so much to think about. Working together in accountability toward a shared goal of creating beloved community. It sounds pretty ideal, doesn't it? And you could say it sounds a lot like what we've already been doing. I mean, this congregation has been reaching out and doing good for the community, working to make positive change for something like almost 200 years. Maybe some of you can actually think of things that we've done already that are already in alignment with the eighth principle. Maybe people on Zoom could go ahead and even type them into the chat box, or people here in the room might raise your hand or just shout them out. Maybe you can think of things that we have done already that are in alignment with the eighth principle. Things like the diversity year that you did with the last interim minister, welcoming congregation, bread of life. I'm looking at the chat room. No one's typed in anything yet. I'm going to give you a second to think. How about some of the books that we've read together? Some of us doing the Beloved Congregations Conversations classes already that are shared and offered online through the UUA. You might even think about today's Maeve Walk. That's a way that we work against violence in the community, and that we're already. Again, the eighth principle includes all kinds of oppression, and that's an oppression against women and against people of different classes. That's a way that all of us can stand up against violence of many kinds. So I think there's plenty that we can do. I'm just gonna check Zoom again. Oh, Jane suggests the day of service that we do for Martin Luther King Day. That is, of course, in alignment with the eighth principle. Mary Beth suggests giving beyond our walls. That's right. Oh, Jean Tai reminds us that we are our church has bolstered and started and participated in the Friends of Melrose Metco. That's something that we've done to support having more students and more diverse students in our schools here in Melrose. There are so many things that we have already done that are already in alignment with the eighth principle. So in a sense, you could say that adopting it wouldn't change anything here in our congregation. And at the same time, we've heard from people in other congregations who have adopted it that actually it feels like it has changed everything. Because by making the implicit explicit, it demonstrates to ourselves and to the world, and most importantly to our siblings of color who are actively requesting that we do this, it shows them that we are listening, that we are taking inclusion and anti-racism seriously, that we are making it a top priority as we move forward. As Katie's story this morning shows us, becoming actively anti-racist demands intention and it demands continuous effort, but the rewards can be bountiful and beautiful, like Beth's story showed us. It can be energizing. And of course, the goal of it, this goal is perhaps the only goal that actually really matters in life, creating beloved community, changing this world into the world that we dream of. How do we get there? Well, we know that MLK charted a path for us, and our UU siblings of color, like Shannon Lang, the woman that Dan was quoting, they're shining a light, and they are beckoning us forward on that path. They are challenging us to keep listening and keep growing, to be like those UU women in the 1980s. These siblings of color are inviting us to update our covenant and our promises to reflect our new and changing awareness. Ours is a living faith. It's held together not by a common creed or shared theology, but by a covenant of promises that we make and remake to one another. And we break and we forgive and we re-engage. This is a set of principles that we hold and we act on, and they're so much more compelling as principles when they reflect who we are in this moment and what we might dare to accomplish. The eighth principle can be an opportunity for us as a congregation and as a denomination to rise to a new level of commitment and challenge. So that's a lot to think about. I'd like to end with a prayer.
Reverend Suzanne? There
Cassandra?
Are two more suggestions in the chat.
Oh, thank you. Someone
from
has
Beth C and Kathy S. And
thank you. So Kathy has suggested that opening doors, our online anti-racism concert series, is something we are already doing in line with the eighth principle. And Beth C says, what about our work with the UU Urban Ministry and what we've done with Renewal House, our annual Christmas gift drive, and the other things we've done with the Urban Ministry? Carol Nestor suggests the benefits that come from the alternative fair. Well, that's really interesting. I hadn't thought about that. So yes, there's so much that we have done already in line with the eighth principle. Thank you, Cassandra, for adding those. So let us pray. Oh, and Cheryl is raising her hand in the back. We've got a suggestion from here in the room. So I hear that without Metco, you wouldn't have met your best friend.
And there's one more.
So they're bringing more people into the schools and giving us more diversity of experience, and that's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. So as we think about that, making this change, let us give ourselves time and space to think about it. And let us pray. Let us listen and learn. Let us discuss and discern what is right for us as a congregation and as a denomination, so that we might find our way forward on this path, a path toward beloved community, toward reconciliation and redemption. In Martin Luther King's words, toward that love that can transform opposers into friends and can bring about miracles. Amen. For our closing hymn today, I have a special video that I want to share with you. It's from our 2018 UU General Assembly. Here is Dr. Glenn Thomas Rideout, who is the music director of our church in Ann Arbor. And he leads us in this glorious hymn that was written by an African-American Christian. And Glenn Thomas begins with an important introduction to the hymn. Now, it runs a little long, and I was a little tempted to cut it, but Glenn Thomas, in his introduction, invites us to engage with the music in a new way, in a different way. And so I've left it long, because I feel that his introduction opens us to listen to the music in a different way. It's actually an invitation to practice eighth principle principles, even in our music. So I urge you to listen with your whole self and open up to a richer spiritual experience of the music. So this is I Need You to Survive from our 2018 GA, led by Dr. Glenn Thomas Rideout. Feel free to sing along. He will tell you how to do that.
One of the most powerful ways the church offers us an opportunity to be one with another is through the power of music. David Frazier wrote a song he calls I Need You to Survive. And I'd like to say that as we endeavor to be a community standing together, affirming the worth and dignity of Black lives, we must enter the songs of Black lives with humility, curiosity, and first, we must endeavor consciously to resist the temptation to colonize it with the changes that make us more comfortable inside of it. If we can be present to Black faith and Black faiths, then in solidarity, we might enter into the blessed relationship that allows us to deserve to be called allies. In this sense, sing this song with me, with curiosity, with humility, and with joined faith.
I need you to survive. I pray for you, you pray for me. I love you, I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you, I need you to.
Let's sing together.
I pray, you pray for me. I love you, I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you, I need you to survive. I pray for you.
You are important to me. Tell two more people, you are important to me.
Please, if you would rise and join me in the chalice extinguishing words. We extinguish the flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Thank you. Please be seated. Our service has ended. In just a minute, folks in Zoom can go into breakout rooms and enjoy our virtual coffee hour. People here can please exit all the way to the front lawn and we can have a chat out there. Please don't forget to reassemble around noon for our finance forum if you like, and maybe see you at the Maeve Walk or tonight at Opening Doors. Thank you so much, everyone, for worshiping with us today. We have a postlude from Beth.